la yang mixer jenge ngon zo lo kalom na nge je zamling xinjiang ji din so be so so ani jom gu rabie kadir cho re an konang ge sung xin ai de xue yin
rahmat salam tibet ve uygur karindaşlarım
good afternoon my uygur and tibetans brothers and sisters
Hem barlık parlament azaları sevgi rahmet.
And members of the parliament and Tibetan activists.
Bizde Xitay bir yıl ilgiri Tibet'ni, bir yıl ilgiri bizni Uygurlarını besip alganmış 65 yıl içinde.
Chinese communist government occupied East Turkestan one year before it occupied Tibet.
Ondaki Mongolia'nı bastı.
Then it occupied Mongolia.
İşki Mongol. Şu 65 yıl içinde fakat şu üç milletli etnik çayetin yok düştü. Hıtay'ın stratejik bir siyaseti olup geldi.
So, for 60, more than 65 years, Chinese Communist government has been trying to assimilate, systematically assimilate Tibetans, Uyghurs and Inner Mongolian peoples.
Mongol karındaşlarımızda asası cehetten asmalası yakıp oldu.
Unfortunately, Chinese government managed to assimilate large part of the Inner Mongolian population.
Lekin Tibet bilen Uygur bizden medeniyetimiz, tarihimiz, ve özümüzden dini itikadımız için biz tohtumayı kureş kırıp ulağı asmalasıya bulmadık.
But Tibetans and Uyghurs and Tibetans have been resisting the Chinese government's repressive policies and managed to keep their religious and national identity until today.
Çünkü Xitay hükümeti degendek ula 5000 yıllık tarih ige olduğundak bizim netçe min yıllık tarih ige en güzel bir mükemmel medeniyetinin igisi.
As Chinese, Han Chinese, Tibetans and Uyghurs also have a long history and contributed to the world civilization.
Şunun için Xitay hükümeti bizde bütünlüğü medeniyetimizde, tilimizde, Hem nefsimizi yok düşün, öldürdü, tuttu, turmalığa taşıdı.
But Uyghurs and Tibetans, of course, paid a very high price to keep their nation, preserve their culture, their religion, and their ethnic identity.
Bunun için biz turmini yattık, minliğen, milyonluğen adamlarımız öldü.
Thousands of Tibetans and Uyghurs have been killed by the Chinese authorities and imprisoned.
Bugün gece Xitay hükümeti öldürüp atıdı, hem sulap atıdı, hem tutup atıdı, hem devletimizden koklap çıkarıp atıdı.
Chinese government continue to kill to in order to eliminate the Uyghurs and Tibetans, continue to kill the Tibetans and Uyghurs and force them to leave their country.
Xitay hükümeti bizni muşunda kırgınçılık kılıç bilen birge dünyaya yani bizgi töhmet çaplar bula bölgünçi terörist diken kalpaklı kaydırıp durup dünyanı aldı atıdı.
Chinese government of course using all tools and state terror to eliminate the Uyghur people and Tibetans and suppress the Uyghurs and Tibetans but accuse them portray them as terrorists to the international community.
Ameliyatta Xitay hükümeti bizim üstümüzden devlet derecelik terörizm hareketini yürgüzüp atadı.
In reality, the Chinese government pursue a terror, state terror against the Tibetan and Uyghurs.
Xitay hükümeti vatanının işi de, vatanımızın işi de bizim zuvanımızın boğup yıkanmasından hatta Birleşken Devletler Teşkilatı da mı Çet ellerde mi bizim zuhanımızı boğmak için?
Chinese government not only tried to silence the Uyghur and Tibetan descent in Tibet in East Turkestan, but it extends its long arm to other countries, even United Nations, to silence the Tibetan and Uyghur and Tibetan voice.
Xitoy hukumati Uyghurlarga Tibetga o'zining kishilik huquqi uchun so'zlash huquqini bergan kuzatish tashkilotlarini huquqini birlashgan davlatlar tashkilotidan ilib tashlasa, buningga yuvan yo'l qo'ydi.
And the Chinese government managed to revoke some of the observer status of the some of the NGOs at the United Nations for their support of the Uyghur and Tibetan cause.
Xitoy hukumati biz tinchlikparvar xalq, Tibet xalqi, Uyghur xalqi azaldan tinchlikparvar xalq. Lekin Xitoy hukumati bizni o'ldirish tutish bilan o'ziga qarshilik majburlayapti.
Uyghurs and Tibetans are peaceful people, peace-loving people. They would like to pursue their struggle peacefully. But Chinese government's state terror and repression lead to bloody incidents in Uyghur region.
And the Birleşken Devletler Teşkilatı'nın muşundak bir diktatör devletke bizde kişilik hukuk talepçilerinin avazını boğuşku yol koyganlıkka katlık narazılığımızı bildiriş için biz bir gün bir yer yığıldık.
We are here to condemn Chinese attempt to silence the Uyghur and Tibetan voice in the United Nations.
Biz birlikte çukum Xitoy hükümetinin bir yerde kişilik hukuk sorunu da payda buluşunu, o hakkı söz içişini, biz gelip dilimizde boğuşuğu yol koymay, biz bu inkılapını birlikte kılımız, bizde kolluğun Tibet karındaşlarımızga ve muş sorunu kegen Uyghur karındaşlarımızga bugün muşundak jirak yakınlığı kegini rahmet etimiz.
And we have to come together and come together and jointly should fight against Chinese government attempts to silence our voices in the United Nations Human Rights Council.
Bizni qollab kelgan barlik siyosiy yo'llarga rahmat.
And I would like to extend my gratitude to all of you for your devotion, for your dedication and sacrifice to come all the way from different countries to attend this joint rally.
Bugün İlham Tohtı degen bizden tanıştık bilen kişilik hukuk bir ziyalerimizde müddetsiz kestikti.
You may all know the Chinese government imprisoned, a sentence to life imprisonment, the peaceful Uyghur dissident İlham Tohtı.
10 minlerce İlham Tohtı turumu düşündüğü yetu atıdı.
We have to know that 10,000s of Ilham Tohti are suffering in Chinese prison.
Bugün Avrupa Parlamenti'nin Saharif mukafatını Uyghur'a bizden Ilham Tohti'ye belgeler için rahmet ettiniz. Hem namazat kılalım için rahmet ettiniz.
We are very happy that the Ilham Tohti is a finalist at the Saharif prize.
Benim sözlerden sözümle tercih kısa vakit getirdikken Tibetlik karındaşlar. Muşu bizden Vice President Ömer Kamat bütün Uyghurlarının ki sözünü sizlerge okuyordu.
So, I prepare actually a written statement and now Ömer Kamat, that's me, will read my written statement to you.
Uyghur kardeşlerim, takap kepbenle, rahmet sizlerine bugün çıdak oltağınınla.
Good afternoon. My Uyghur and Tibetan brothers and sisters, I'm very pleased to welcome you all. I would like to extend my gratitude to you all for your dedication, devotion and sacrifice for attending this joint protest rally to condemn Chinese government's repressive policies in East Turkestan in Tibet, its ongoing brutal crackdown on Uyghurs and Tibetans, its religious restriction, its new anti-terrorism law and its illegitimate attempt to silence Uyghur and Tibetan human rights activists' voice in UN Human Rights Council. I'm honored to be here today among so many Uyghur and Tibetan human rights defenders from around the world who came to this wonderful city to join hands together in our struggle for our common destiny for freedom, human rights and democracy. Only when we all come together to fight against Chinese government in powers of darkness in Beijing, then there shall be freedom and human rights for Uyghurs, Tibetans, and as well as Han Chinese people. As you all know, East Turkestan was occupied by Communist China in October 1949, 1 year before it occupied Tibet. In 1955, the Chinese government designated East Turkestan an autonomous region, renaming it Xinjiang Uyghur Autonomous Region, and promised that it will respect the cultural, economic, political, and religious rights of the people of East Turkestan. Under these terms, the Chinese government also promised to respect Uyghurs' right of self-determination as well. However, the Chinese government never kept its promises, and like Tibet, there is no sign of autonomy in East Turkestan. Both the Tibetan and the Uyghurs have been suffering from systematic human rights abuses at the hands of the Chinese government for decades. The Chinese government has dramatically increased its repression in East Turkestan since the devastating September 11 terrorist attacks. Unfortunately, the Chinese government has used the international war on terror as a pretext to crack down further on Uyghur people. It was easy for China to label Uyghurs as terrorists because Uyghurs happen to be Muslim. The Chinese government has launched numerous strike hard campaigns on the Uyghurs, has arrested and detained thousands of peaceful Uyghur activists, and has executed hundreds of dissidents and religious figures, accusing them as terrorists and separatists. In 2001, the Chinese authorities launched a wholesale attack on Uyghur culture, language, religion, and national identity, and began implementing open assimilation policies that it couldn't dare to implement in the past. An official policy recruits young Uyghur women from majority Uyghur areas of East Turkestan to be transferred to work in factories in urban areas of East China. Under the policy, thousands of Uyghur women have been removed from their homes, sent away from their families, and placed into substandard housing in working conditions thousands of miles away. Already hundreds of thousands of young Uyghur women have been transferred from East Turkestan to Beijing, Tianjin, Jiangsu, Qingdao, Shandong, Zhejiang, and other locations in China. The mass in-migration of Han Chinese settlers and the out-migration of young Uyghur women to East China has dramatically changed the demographics of East Turkestan. The Chinese government's malicious repression has become physically, mentally, and emotionally unbearable to the vast majority of Uyghurs. These repressive policies have led to a series of bloody incidents in East Turkestan. The upsurge in extrajudicial killings of Uyghurs, influx of special security forces, shoot and kill policy, and widespread heavy-handed repression, so-called anti-terror military drill using new weaponry system in recent years, has turned East Turkestan almost into a war zone. In last 3 years, according to the Chinese government reports, more than 400 Uyghurs have been killed and approximately 600 people injured. Within the same period, thousands of people were arrested for political reasons, and more than 80 Uyghurs have been executed without due process. In addition to this, there are numerous cases of forced disappearances, which has increasingly become a standard operating procedure of Chinese security forces. Already, the number of incidents of mass arrests, forced disappearances, unlawful executions reported has reached an unprecedented level, a level that needs to be addressed internationally. In the absence of strong international pressure against the Chinese authorities, East Turkestan may witness an increasing number of massacres and killings of Uyghurs by Chinese security forces. Under President Xi Jinping, the Chinese authorities have seemingly replaced any sort of legal process even bugus trials with an outright on the spot shoot and kill policy toward Uyghur dissident. In one instance, authorities killed Uyghurs, confiscated their bodies in the desert, and then fabricated a reason later. In almost all the bloody incidents which occurred in the last 3 years in East Turkestan, the Chinese government has blamed terrorists for the incidents without providing a shred of evidence. Serious allegations such as these require a body of verifiable evidence, and the Chinese authorities are never forthcoming when asked to provide it in case of so-called Uyghur terrorism. The use of brutal force and terror allegations are merely a tool to silence legitimate Uyghur dissent. Many of the incidents are explained through local grievances. However, in each case, failed Chinese policies of repression are at fault. In 2014, the Chinese government repression intensified dramatically following Xi Jinping's visit to East Turkestan. Chinese authorities launched one-year-long strike hard campaign in East Turkestan and tightened religious restrictions. The government's 2014 strike hard anti-terror campaign was extended and wide-scale restrictions were imposed against Uyghur Muslim religious practices. Thousands were detained in security sweeps, some with deadly force, and jail sentences were given out for wearing religious attire, for taking part in religious gatherings or activities, and were forbidden from fasting during the holy month of Ramadan. Chinese authorities banned civil servants, students, and teachers from fasting during Ramadan. School children and government workers were provided food and water in the middle of the day as a clear attempt to prohibit the practice. In a further insult to the dignity of the Uyghur people, back in February 2015, the government forced imams to dance in a public square and to swear to an oath that they will not teach religion to children. Last year, the authorities started forcing low-income families to agree to abandon some Muslim traditions in exchange for social security payments. Setting aside the fact that these prohibitions are clearly in contravention of internationally recognized human rights law, they also serve only to deepen the conflict and tension in East Turkestan and fuel further Uyghur resentment of Chinese government and its unreasonable policies. On the other hand, China introduced new laws and regulations in order to legitimize its bloody crackdown and religious restrictions on Uyghur people. Chinese new anti-terrorism law means further repression. It will allow Chinese security forces to intensify its bloody crackdown in East Turkestan and Tibet to silence further the peaceful dissent. The definition of terrorism and vague is vague enough to be interpreted by the Chinese law enforcement forces in any form they want. The new law also places restrictions on the reporting of so-called terrorist attacks and government responses. Pursuant to the new law, no one is allowed to disseminate details of so-called terrorist incidents that may lead to copycat, nor may they spread cruel or inhuman images. The new law also restricts the right of the media to report on detail of terrorist attacks, including a provision that media and social media cannot report on details of terror activities that might lead to imitation. The new anti-terrorism law in case of Uyghurs means more extrajudicial killings, more disappearances, more detention and arrest, more imprisonment of Uyghur activists. The anti-terrorism law also permits the People's Liberation Army to get involved in anti-terrorism operation overseas. China wants to extend its long arm to other countries to silence Uyghur and Tibetan in Chinese human rights activists and make difficult for them to carry out their activities. Whether it is regional, the regional tightening of religious freedom, religious restrictions, illegal state grabs of land from Uyghurs, or the deployment of heavy-handed policing, the local implication of such repressions are now in evidence. The response in almost every case is state violence and the escalation of tensions. Today, Uyghur people are increasingly feeling they are facing an existential threat under China's aggressive policies of cultural genocide, targeting Uyghur identity, language, culture, and religious belief and practices. And the state sanctioned use of lethal force in any kind of dispute or confrontation between Chinese security forces and ordinary Uyghur. As history will tell us, the ensuing government repression of the Uyghur people creates a vicious cycle. Contrary to the Chinese government's propaganda, stability of China's entire country is compromised by the failed ethnic policies in East Turkestan and Tibet. Uyghurs' resistance toward China is directly linked to continued repression. However, the Chinese government likes to stir unrest and resistance because it is that very resistance that creates modern-day tensions. I encourage the international community to vigorously see to it that the Uyghurs' merit grievances are heard and China change its repressive policies in East Turkestan and Tibet. Chinese government has already committed crimes against humanity, unspeakable atrocities against Uyghur people and Tibetans. However, it's not too late for the Chinese government to lend an ear to the Tibetan and Uyghur people and ultimately improve. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Rubia Kadir and Omar Khanat, for this presentation. I think we will continue to be in solidarity, the Tibetans, the Uyghurs, also the Tibet supporters, and have a close watch on what is going on in East Turkestan, because it matters. It matters for entire China, for the peoples, for all those who live under the rule of the People's Republic of China. I would now like to invite to the stage a very strong Tibet supporter who is coming from a country that has been a great inspiration for so many, and I would just like to, which is the Czech Republic, which many of us know from President Václav Havel's friendship to His Holiness the Dalai Lama, who gave so much support for the Tibetan cause and was such a strong speaker for Tibetan issues and for all those who don't have a strong voice on the international stage, who are marginalized, who are not at the center of attention. I would like to invite the former Vice Premier, indeed, of the Czech Republic and Minister for Environment, Mr. Martin Busík, on the stage to give a welcome to us. Thank you.
Jom rabia khadir ta an konang ge sungjur nabani jalo la ning thapa ne tu che shue yin an de che la lengge zo ngra zo phiri mi ma yong zo la se ra shue che la chene phiri mi ma ne ning gung che la de lengge zo de sa cha sa ba yin za ta rong bo ga sa ka la phe mo go ya din de ge kang ma sam ji me cha ba jun je an khala dam che dam ju ne ga dam da kha ji ji tha di ju du ji du an che na ba zo zerim de ma sa ba du tu le le ji shu ro ji अन कोना जो के शेला तो जो कोंग देव दां अन दम जे दम जो ये सर रे दिला अन कोंग बशिरो जी सुए ही अन तादी चला आना जो के चेक अन चितुन जी का की सुने शंभ बतां कोरियो लेंचे सुरुपा अन कोना अंके चल या तंदा मार्टिन पर्सी चो शुगर है अन कोना के कलब नारोना सुए ही
दशिदलेक
Yeah.
Dear Tibetan friends, dear friends of Tibet, that's all us here, either Tibetan or friends of Tibet. I came here from Prague, Czech Republic, to express the support of the citizens of the Czech Republic for their fight of Tibetans and of Uyghurs for their freedom. At the beginning, I want to explain you the story of my nation. To show you the parallel of the history of the Czech Republic and Tibet. And the reason I want to tell you about that is that our story is having a happy end. Czech Republic is a free, democratic country, and I believe that Tibet will be free. And that Uyghurs will be free. A few days ago in Brussels, Sikyong Lobsang Sangay, a very smart leader of Tibetans, said, "I believe we will meet on the square in front of Jogang. All we will meet there. We will dance, we will drink chang, and we will celebrate. We all will be there." So I tell you the story. In 1948, the communists took over the power in my country. In 1950, the communists took over the power in Tibet. And there was the first exile of the intellectuals of a number of people abroad. In 1968, Soviet army invaded my country. In 1950, Chinese invaded Tibet. We experienced the exile government, and not only that, we also experienced the life tortures, the people who committed suicide, self-immolation. In January 1969, first student Jan Palach died, and there were 26 attempts of a self-immolation. Three people died. And we have 144 people who self-immolated, Tibetans. And now we have the three cases of nuns in Larungar. So sad, so sad. We lived in the under the communism, and there it looked like there was no hope for freedom. And suddenly, the Berlin Wall fell down. Suddenly, November 1989, the Velvet Revolution, and we got free. Václav Havel, the dissident, became president of the country. And we became a nation, a country, which is supporting human rights and is fighting against violation of human rights anywhere in the world. Václav Havel, our first president, was the first head of state who invited His Holiness Dalai Lama for the official visit of Czechoslovakia. It was February 1990. Since then, on the 10th of March, the day of Tibet, thousands of city halls around the country show the Tibetan flags. Thousands of schools and individuals are showing the Tibetan flags as a solidarity with Tibetan people. Because we know how solidarity is important, how it is important to know and to feel that there is someone in the democratic world who stands behind you. In March this year, Chinese President Xi Jinping visited Czech Republic, Prague, for the first time. And me and my wife and the organizations called Czechs Support Tibet organized a big gathering, demonstration, with 1,500 people. And the police put a ban on a demonstration. They did not allow us together. They violated our constitutional right, and we sue the police, the city of Prague, and the Minister for Interior, we put them to the court because they violated the constitutional right. Why I am telling this is that we've been experiencing it in Denmark, in Britain, in the Czech Republic, that the Chinese are trying to enforce the democratic leaders of the countries to accept their rules. And the police is protecting the Chinese demonstrants and letting them to violate our rights, which is unfair. We cannot let this to continue anymore. We are standing in front of the United Nations, and I want to put a question. If 1.2 million Tibetan people died because of being killed or hunger since 1950, it is one-fifth of the population of Tibet. Isn't it a genocide? It is. And the United Nations should really act. Release the political prisoners. It is urgent. Tibet needs a dialogue. Xi Jinping and the Chinese communists open a dialogue with the Tibetan government in exile and with Xi Jinping or with the ambassadors of His Holiness. And let me speak by the end of my speech about the environment, because I'm environmentalist and no one has mentioned environment so far. Tibet is the roof of the world. Five most important rivers are coming from Himalayas. More than a billion people are dependent on these rivers. There are 86,000 glaciers in Tibet. I'm a climber, I was in Tibet. I was illegally in Tibet in 1988, I was in Lhasa. And I crossed the mountains through Nangpa La. Who of you crossed Nangpa La to escape for democracy? Not easy. And these glaciers are melting, and what is very important is that there are 2.3 million nomads who were resettled to the socialist villages. They are not allowed to continue their nomadic way of life. But this has got a very negative influence on the environment. Because as you of course know, Tibet, because Tibetan plateau, because of its attitude of 4,400 meters in average, there is a permafrost. And this frozen land, permafrost, keeps the carbon dioxide fixed in a permafrost. It's 12.3 million tons of methane is fixed in a permafrost. Methane is 14 times more aggressive than carbon dioxide. When the permafrost melts, no one can stop it. No one can stop that. And it will really create a disaster for the whole world. So it is very urgent so that the Chinese stop resettlement of the nomads and allow the local people live their way of life, because this is the only way how to sacrifice and save the pastures, and which will not be transformed into the deserts, because in deserts the permafrost will melt, and that's going to be the environmental disaster of the world scale. So this is why Tibet is so important for the environment of the whole planet. We will keep on supporting Tibetans and Uyghurs until you will be free. Long live the Dalai Lama.
Long live the Dalai Lama.
Long live Lobsang Sangay.
Long live Lobsang Sangay.
Free Tibet, free Uyghurs. Thank you very much, Dashi Dilek.
Thank you very much, Martin Bursik, for this very inspirational speech. And I think it is clear that also the environment plays in a hugely important role, not only for Tibetans, but for us here living in Europe, and of course for the Chinese themselves and for everybody in Asia who is dependent on that, those resources, such as water. Now, I would like to invite somebody from Switzerland onto the stage. And as an expression of the fact, one may say, that support is not just support, but also friendship. And friendship is important. Tibetans don't just enjoy support, but also enjoy friendship of people here in their host countries, namely, particularly in Switzerland. So please, Mr. Jose Amrain Murer, I would like to invite you to the stage for me, Swiss-Tibetan Friendship Association.
For change a little, I will say some words first in French and then in German I will continue. Cher Nodouk Dorjela, représentant de la sainteté le Dalai Lama, cher Rabia Kadir, représentante du peuple Ouïghour, chère conseillère fédérale Lisa Mazzone, chers amis et chers amis, au nom de l'association Amitié Helvético-Tibétaine, je remercie sincèrement les organisateurs de cette manifestation de nous donner la possibilité d'exprimer une fois de plus notre solidarité avec le peuple tibétain et d'accuser le gouvernement chinois pour sa grave et constante oppression des minorités ethniques. En faveur des personnes qui ne parlent pas le français mais comprennent l'allemand, et c'est la majorité des Tibétains qui vivent en Suisse, je vais continuer en allemand. Dem Vorstand der Gesellschaft Schweizerisch-Tibetische Freundschaft, GSDF, liegt die Zusammenarbeit über ideologische und geografische Grenzen hinweg am Herzen. Deswegen freuen wir uns, dass es in dieser Kundgebung auch um das Schicksal des uigurischen Volkes geht. Es sind unzählige barbarische Aktionen, unter denen das tibetische Volk zu leiden hat, so auch schwerwiegende Umweltzerstörungen, wie wir eben gehört haben. Ein konkretes Beispiel sind die Minenarbeiten am Gong Nong Lari, einem den Tibeter heiligen Berg im Nordosten Tibets. Berechtigte Proteste mehrerer tausend Tibeterinnen und Tibeter wurden niedergeschlagen und zahlreiche Protestierende eingesperrt. In diesem Zusammenhang schrieben die Präsidenten der Tibetergemeinschaft Ningbo Tenzin und der Gesellschaft Schweizerisch-Tibetische Freundschaft Thomas Büchli am 8. Juli einen Brief an den Bundesrat Didier Burkhalter und an die Nationalratspräsidentin Christa Markwalder. Die Schreibenden forderten die beiden Adressaten dringlich auf, die Regierung der Volksrepublik China zur Achtung ihrer Umweltgesetze, der Menschenrechte und der tibetischen Religion und Kultur nachhaltig aufzurufen. Am 18. August antwortete Bundesrat Didier Burkhalter: Gerne lese ich Ihnen aus diesem Brief einige Auszüge vor. Der schweizerische Außenminister schreibt unter anderem: Der universelle Schutz der Menschenrechte gehört zu den zentralen Werten, Zielen und Interessen der Schweiz und demnach zu den wichtigsten Aufgaben
der schweizerischen Außenpolitik. Entsprechend setzen wir uns für den Schutz der Tibeter in China ein, dies auf multilateraler Ebene als auch in bilateralen Beziehungen. Sind das leere Worte? Bundesrat Burkhalter weiß offenbar um diese Befürchtung und erwähnt nun in seinem Brief zwei konkrete Aktionen. Während der letzten Session des UNO-Menschenrechtsrates im Juni 2016 hat die Schweiz ihre Besorgnis über die Einschränkungen der Religions- und Meinungsäußerungs- und Bewegungsfreiheit der nationalen Minderheiten in China, insbesondere in den tibetischen Gebieten, ausgedrückt und China aufgerufen, die fundamentalen Rechte aller Individuen zu garantieren, inklusive der Mitglieder von ethnischen und religiösen Minderheiten. Zudem, so fährt Bundesrat Burkhalter fort, hat die Schweiz während der zweiten Runde der universellen regelmäßigen Überprüfung Chinas im UNO-Menschenrechtsrat eine Empfehlung zur Ermöglichung eines Besuches des UNO-Hochkommissars für Menschenrechte in die tibetischen und uigurischen Gebiete abgegeben und diese Empfehlung wurde von China akzeptiert und erlaubt, diese Thematik nun mit China verstärkt aufzunehmen. Soweit Bundesrat Burkhalter. Wir sind ihm dankbar für diese Antwort und wir wünschen ihm und seinen Mitarbeiterinnen und Mitarbeitern, dass sie diesen Worten entsprechend nun weitere und immer entschiedenere Taten setzen. Als besonders wichtig erachten wir dabei die erwähnte Entsendung eines UN-Beobachters des UNO-Hochkommissariates für Menschenrechte in die tibetischen und uigurischen Gebiete. Den Druck auf dieses Anliegen aufrechtzuerhalten, ist auch eine der zentralen Aufgaben der Parlamentarierkommission der GSDF. Lisa Mazzone, die gleich sprechen wird, gehört ebenfalls zu dieser Parlamentarierkommission. En ce sens, je finis mes mots avec un décidé Free Tibet and Free East Turkestan.
Merci, José Amrain Muga. Now I would like to ask Mr. Nodop Dorji to the microphone, who is the representative of His Holiness the Dalai Lama here in Geneva. Please. Today, we gathered here in front of the United Nations Human Rights Building, world's only place where civil societies who raise their voice of suffering and victimized under the regime of atrocities and violations of basic human rights in this world. We gathered here to show our solidarity with Tibetans and Uyghurs who are suffering inside Tibet and East Turkestan, and to sensitize the gross violations of universal declarations of human rights in Tibet and Turkestan by Chinese government since 1959. Recent reports suggest that the Chinese government is taking measures to make self-immolation a separatist-related crime. In the past, the government has resorted to criminalization of the self-immolator's family member. Such tyrannical measures will only exacerbate the situation inside Tibet and only validate the reputations of Chinese government as a repressive regime. Instead, heading to the legitimate grievances of Tibetan people inside Tibet and according to them, the rights they are entitled to will address the aspirations of the Tibetan people. Tibetan language plays a crucial role in the preservation of Tibetan culture and distinct Tibetan identity. Tibetan runs schools aiming to teach and develop the young Tibetan with Tibetan cultures and language, face severe restrictions from Chinese authorities. Many such schools have been sealed off under the charge of being separatists and endangering state security. For centuries, Tibetan nomads and herders have lived successfully with their herds using their centuries-old traditional knowledge and by keeping a mobile lifestyle. However, the current forced villagization policy in the name of development under the inherent skills of nomad restrict their mobility and raise serious concern about the long-term socio-economic impacts of removing nomads from their traditional form of livelihood without adequate planning. Tibetans living in Chinese-ruled Tibet have no freedom and opportunities. They are under pressure at all times to be careful and cautious about how they carry on their day-to-day living. Besides, the government of China continues to exercise such severe control and restrictions as to affect a day-to-day degeneration of the Tibetan people's custom, religion, culture, and language. Just few examples will suffice to prove this point. In 2007, China issued what it called measures on the management of the reincarnations of living Buddha. And in 2015, it launched an online database of living Buddha. These are clear proof that China exercises severe control on Tibet's unique religious systems of reincarnation. And this proof is further reinforced by the fact that this year the government of China launched a drive to demolish residence of monks and nuns at the Lalungar Buddhist Academy so as to reduce the student population at this globally famed center for the study of Tibetan Buddhism. The situation of the political prisoners in Chinese-ruled Tibet too has been continuing to get more severe. Many of them are given long prison sentence and without any considerations of their health and physical condition. Many Tibetan political prisoners are subjected to such severe and brutal beating and tortures that some of them die in prison. The most prominent example of such death is that of the highly respected religious figure Trungpa Tenzin Delek Rinpoche. Some of the Tibetan political prisoners, although released, failed to remain alive to government resulting from severe ill treatment during their incarceration. For few reports, examples of such cases are that of Guy Pinto and Nomad of Dometolo. Another reported example is that of Ashatang Norla of Kamderge. Yet another very recent example is that of Mong Kherab of Dingdi Shegar Monastery near Shigatse. As per Chinese Article 18 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights ensure the freedom of religion and belief. However, the situation in Tibet Autonomous Region and the adjacent areas where Tibetans live are deprived of such freedom in reality. The space for Tibetans to carry out their own religion activities and practice in the monastery is a high risk. As per Article 36 of the Chinese Constitution, not only provides the citizens enjoy religious freedoms and belief, but forbids any state organ, public organizations, or individuals from forcing citizens to believe in or not to believe in any religions, or to discriminate against citizens who believe in or do not believe in any religion. China's announcement of a second major crackdown on Lulunga once again renders hollow this constitutional provision. Chinese policies of infrastructure development, mining, and rapid urbanizations have aggravated environmental degradation across Tibet, impacting the quality and the quantity of the water resources, which affect multiple downstream nations. Chinese first faced large hydropower and water diversion projects on the Tibetan plateau have already started, impacting water quality and fresh water fish in Tibet. If these dam projects continue operation or are implemented at the current rate, the water security of nearly 1.4 billion people of downstream will be heavily affected. On 13th of this month, the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights has made remarks that discussions with Chinese over the past 11 years regarding the official mission by successive high commissioners have so far failed to produce an actual commitment to move ahead with the visit. I remain deeply concerned, however, over reports of continued harassment of human rights lawyers, human rights defenders and their family members, as well as allegations of discrimination, torture and ill treatment, enforced disappearance and deaths in custody of members of ethnic and religious communities, he added. The policy of Tibetan leadership in exile on the mutually acceptable solutions is quite straightforward. This policy is called Umelam, the middle way approach, which was conceived by His Holiness Dalai Lama in the spirit of nonviolence. The basic feature and guiding thoughts of the Umelam approach of His Holiness Dalai Lama are the fundamental belief in nonviolence approach as the only human, sensible and intelligent way to overcome clash of interest and conflict in the 21st century. The pursuit of dialogue and negotiations as the principal means to resolve conflict, and the exercise of political federations and restraints from adopting maximalist position in the process of negotiation. The conduct of the dialogue and negotiation in the spirit of reconciliation, aiming for mutual agreement, mutual benefit, and for solution with no victor and no vanquished. We therefore need to emphasize the unique nature of the Tibetan freedom struggle and its universal appeal as a role model for other oppressed and persecuted people, highlighting the fact that support for the cause of Tibet represents also an investment in the promotion of a global political culture of non-violence, dialogue and reconciliation. So we would like to appeal to the international communities, government and civil societies that never undermine the non-violent struggle for the Tibetan people. So we need your support, we need your voice. So today, more than 1,500 people gathered here from different countries, including Russia, France, Germany, Czech Republic, Switzerland and Liechtenstein, urgently call for an end to the systematic violations of the religious freedoms of Tibetan and Uyghurs and all Buddhists in the PRC. The Chinese government must stop the persecution and control of Tibetan Buddhism and respect international human rights standard in Tibet and beyond. The international community, government, parliament and civil societies must act to seek prevent the Chinese government from destroying the unique cultures and religion. So with this word, I would like to enter here and once again take this opportunity to offer my thanks to all the invited guests and general public at this gathering. Thank you, Tashdele.
Thank you very much, Nurdup Dorjila, for these important remarks. And having heard remarks from the administration, if I may say so, now it's of course good practice to hear a parliamentarian, and that would be Thubten Wangchenla from the Tibetan Parliament in Exile, and I would like to ask him to speak to us now. Thubten Wangchenla, please.
Respected dear speakers and Tibetans and brothers and sisters of Uyghurs who join here today, I want to say thank you for everybody who participated and who attended this special event in front of UNO. We are not here today to celebrate or make a party or picnic. We are here today in front of UN to request them, to ask them, and to appeal the UN that the country, one nation, Tibet, is suffering. And also our brother, sister of Uyghur, is also suffering under the Chinese regime, Chinese government, and communist China. Therefore, we thought this is a very important moment, gathering in front of UN near to the broken chair is a big symbol that we humans really have no enough and real human rights. Every sentient being have a right to live in peace and freedom. But we know that the Chinese government no respect either their Chinese brothers or sisters. They have no freedom, they have no human rights in China and also in Tibet. What is happening? Already gone, 57 years passed, but international community and UN are silenced. Nobody wants to move. Nobody wants to open their mouth. It's silence because the interest of Chinese government, Chinese negotiation, Chinese money and made in China. This is, we can say very clear with encouragement, we can say that. We Tibetan people are peace-loving people. We like follow Mahatma Gandhi and we are following our leadership. His Holiness the Dalai Lama teaches us and lead us to base on truth, justice and non-violence. Is our arms, our instrument. Chinese, their instrument is the weapons, machine guns to destroy the freedom and liberty of humans. Anyway, I'm not going to talk too much because all the earlier speakers, they mentioned. Now, I'm the second last speaker and I'm really happy to be here, proud to be here in front of UN to speak. This morning I fly from Barcelona to be here with Tibetan brother, sister, and Uyghur brother, sister, to see and say some words from my heart. We Tibetans and Uyghur, we are fighting for justice and freedom. And we are not really, we don't want bloodshed. We don't want the violence. We want to follow Dalai Lama's message and Mahatma Gandhi until the Tibet. Sure, the Tibet will be free and Uyghur will be free soon. Everything is impermanent. Nothing lasts forever. Therefore, some moment is they have sun, now there's no sun. It's nearly to rain, it's normal. If it's sun, we have to enjoy. If it rains, we must enjoy, you know, any moment. Because we Tibetans, now in Switzerland, nearly 7,000 Tibetans living in Switzerland. Today, nearly 1,000 here. Okay, that's good. I'm not discouraging anyone. I want to say who are here. I want to say thank you and many, many. Yes, this is why we are here. The main purpose is for our 6 million brothers and sisters who are suffering inside Tibet. They have no freedom. Yes, they cannot open their mouth. So we, free country, Tibetans, we are looking, fighting for our own country. And we have to go in the first front and then we need to support groups, international support groups, the parliament members and politicians we need behind us. Therefore, I want to say it's a nice moment. His Holiness Dalai Lama, 81 years old, he untirelessly, he is traveling. You know, he's next in Strasbourg today. He is traveling for us, for the Tibetan struggle, for the freedom of Tibet. Therefore, really, please think, we Tibetan, young Tibetans, we should enjoy living in free country like Switzerland. But we also don't forget our brother and sister who are suffering. Just before our Nyima Lhamula talked about the Tenzin Delep Rinpoche's, the suffering, the problem. Tibet needs dialogue. And where's the Panchen Lama? We want to know where about Panchen Lama. China's silence, UNO, never speak about that. This is what is happening. Anyway, yeah, don't give up. Don't give up. We have still Dalai Lama with us. His Holiness will never abandon us. So as long as His Holiness is with us, we can enjoy, we can return, we can return back to our country, Tibet, with our 6 million brothers, sisters. And this is what our dream. The dream is a dream, it is, but dream will come true one day. So one day, the Rabia Kadir, she spoke about the freedom of the Uyghur people. Of course, don't don't lose your hope. And Tibetans, we will never lose our hope. We will keep on struggle through non-violence and guidance of His Holiness Dalai Lama. So I want to say, conclude everything that thanks for the organizer, yes, ICT, and the Tibetan community of Switzerland and Liechtenstein, and the Bureau of Tibet, Office of Tibet, having organized this one, this event, really important. And anyway, this won't be waste our time. We came from far away, and to be here, many speakers talk a lot, but I don't think this is disappearing in the air. UNO will listen our words, and so, okay, thank you very much, and Pergelo, and free Tibet.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wangchen. We will not give up, and somebody who is supporting us and giving very important support is Miss Lisa Mazzone, a member of Swiss Parliament, and this support from parliaments, from national parliaments, is so incredibly important that I'm very happy to have her here today as our chief guest indeed, and that she's taken the time off her very busy schedule here. This support is indispensable. It is so important from national parliaments, and I'm very happy to have her here on the stage right now, Ms.
Mazzone. Cham Lisa Mazzone chone sunshe kalop nangire an dil changlo ge dis thungnang da chajo na ro na shwe cha da ga da kangse chi de le tu cha na
Madame la représentante du peuple ouïghour, monsieur le représentant de sa santé Dalai Lama, bonjour à toutes et à tous et merci beaucoup de me donner l'honneur de parler devant vous aujourd'hui. En tant que genevoise, j'habite à quelques rues d'ici. Je suis très honorée de vous accueillir ici, mais je dois vous avouer que je préférerais nettement que vous n'ayez pas à venir devant les Nations Unies, parce que je préférerais nettement que vous soyez libre. Je viens vous parler ici au nom du groupe parlementaire qui accorde sa solidarité avec le Tibet et avec le peuple ouïghour. C'est un groupe parlementaire qui existe au sein de la Suisse, qui recueille plusieurs parlementaires de partis différents qui s'engagent pour la liberté, pour vous soutenir dans la lutte, dans votre combat pour la liberté de religion et pour le respect de vos droits fondamentaux. Ce groupe parlementaire s'engage au quotidien au sein de notre Parlement. Ce groupe parlementaire dépose régulièrement des interpellations, sollicite le Conseil fédéral pour qu'il s'exprime sur sa solidarité avec le peuple Tibet. À cet égard, Maya Graf, ancienne conseillère présidente du Conseil national, a accueilli en 2013 devant le Palais fédéral le Dalai Lama et ce fut un grand honneur. Je suis ici pour vous transmettre notre soutien au peuple tibétain et ouïghour, pour dénoncer aussi les atteintes aux droits de l'homme et à la liberté de religion. Nous sommes brisés et consternés d'apprendre ce qui se passe, et nous sommes brisés devant le nombre d'immolations qui doivent avoir lieu pour revendiquer des droits fondamentaux, des droits universels. Nous sommes préoccupés par la situation et nous dénonçons les répressions, nous dénonçons les menaces, les calomnies. Nous dénonçons également les détentions arbitraires, les déplacements forcés. Les droits humains, pour nous, sont des droits fondamentaux. Ce sont des droits qui ne sont pas négociables et c'est aussi le rôle de la Suisse de les défendre tout autour de la planète. Nous déplorons également les événements qui ont lieu cet été. Et nous tenons ici à vous apporter notre soutien. Vous portez ici la voix du peuple tibétain. Et nous, c'est à nous de vous entendre et de pouvoir la porter plus loin avec vous. Nous avons en Suisse aussi une responsabilité. Ces droits, comme je les ai dit, sont des droits universels. Ce sont des droits qu'on doit défendre tout autour de la planète. Des droits au respect de la religion et aux libertés. Et aujourd'hui, nous appelons la communauté internationale, nous appelons le Conseil fédéral à faire pression sur la Chine, sur le gouvernement chinois, pour qu'il respecte enfin les droits de toutes et tous, les droits du peuple tibétain, les droits des Ouïghours. Je dois vous dire à titre personnel que j'admire votre courage et votre persévérance, j'admire votre culture du dialogue. Je pense que nous avons beaucoup à apprendre de votre culture du dialogue et j'aimerais, en tant que représentante du groupe parlementaire de solidarité avec le Tibet, dialoguer avec vous pour pouvoir mettre fin aux atteintes aux droits humains et pour pouvoir assurer les libertés fondamentales des Tibétains et des Ouïghours. Je vous remercie.
And friends of Tibet, on behalf of Tibetan community in Switzerland and the Office of Tibet at Geneva, we would like to express our heartfelt gratitude and appreciation to the International Tibet Support Group, individuals, organizations, and to all of you who came here to raise your voice against the unjust and oppression and supporting non-violent struggle of Tibetan people. We are deeply thankful to all speakers and those who sent us their support and message and dedication on our common cause. I will ask our president and Mr. Ngudubla to hand over our traditional scarves to the speakers. And special thanks to our chief guest, Lisa Mozani, Swiss Member of Parliament. Venerable Thupten Wangchen, Tibetan Member of Parliament in Europe. Mr. Martin Bursek, former Vice Prime Minister and Minister of Environment of Czech Republic. Ms. Rabia Kadir, World Uyghur Congress. Ms. Nimal Hamula, niece of late Chogu Tenzin Derek Rinpoche. Mr. Jose Amrain Murer, Swiss Tibetan Friendship Association. Mr. Jonas Olke, representative of Mr. Thomas Mann, member of European Parliament, and the President of Tibet Interest Group. And last but not least, Mr. Kai Müller, International Campaign for Tibet. I, on behalf of President of Tibetan Community in Switzerland and myself, would like to express our special heartfelt thanks to Mr. Ngudub Dorjila, representative of Tibet, His Holiness the Dalai Lama, and Office of Tibet at Geneva, and his crew members, who shoulder the main responsibility of organizing coordination of this grand rally at Geneva. Thank you, Mr. Ngodubla. As you all know, Tibetans inside Tibet have no peace, no voice, no freedom. We Tibetans in exile are the voice of voiceless. The worsening of human rights situation in Tibet, repression of religious freedom, suppression of Tibetan identity and its culture and its language. To promote our non-violent struggle and peaceful means to stop the suppression and demolition of cultural heritage in Tibet. So let us work hard and follow the restless efforts of His Holiness the Great 14th Dalai Lama, the ambassador of peace and compassion, the champion of Ahimsa, a source of light to the generation of 21st century. His Holiness has said, how strong the evil wind will blow, the truth of flame will never extinguish. Therefore, every single voice counts and every single voice becomes more visible. And with international community and the truth at our side, one day the leaders in Beijing have to bow in front of injustice and humanity. We have now come to the end of the rally. Once again, thank you very much, and have a nice trip to home. Tashi Dele.
Sanjo, Sanjo, Remo.
Once again, on behalf of Tibetan community, in Switzerland, Liechtenstein, Abiba, would like to offer our Tibetan scraps to our heartfelt Dzongchila. I ask Mr. President to hand over the scarf for his enormous work and organizing and fundraising for this grand rally in Geneva. And one scarf for the Russian, I'm sorry, your name. She came from Russia and from Tibet House. Yeah. Sorry, thank you very much.
Qarindoshlar, Robiya xonimningki so'zi vaqa shunaqa sizlar ketmay ketib qolmanglar. Saqlab turinglar, yana hech kim ketmasin. Mana taqilgandan keyin o'zimiz bir 5-10 minut bayadi ko'rishib olib, endiki mangamiz shunaqa ketib qolmanglar. Rahmat. Bir yaqin ish qilib turaylik hammaylar.
Wake up! You ain't no! Thank you.